Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Human Resolve podcast. I'm here with my special guest, Siwat Siengsanaoh. Siwat, please introduce yourself.
Hello, Savio. Thank you for having me today. An introduction on myself. My name is Siwat Siengsanaoh. I am the co-founder of Recoup Beverage. Recoup is a ginger-powered health and hydration beverage. Every bottle of Recoup has 2 teaspoons of ginger, which has been known to help with muscle soreness, aches and pains, nausea, vomiting, boost immunity, and a ton of amazing things that ginger has been known to do. We use 2 teaspoons of ginger in every bottle of Recoup, and that's the same that's been used in medical studies to help with various things such as nausea and vomiting. Let's see, what else? I was born and raised in New York City. I grew up in New Jersey. I spent most of my time on the Northeast, New Jersey and New York City. I've lived in New York now for, gosh, I think 20 years. So I think it's safe to say I'm a New Yorker.
Wonderful. So see what you and I connected because you were so kind in contributing to my interview series with Authority Magazine, Rising Through Resilience, How to Be Resilient During Turbulent Times. And what I found really most intriguing and also what I really had a great affinity towards is this idea of learning to be comfortable in the unknown. Can you expound a little bit on that?
Sure. I think with age, I've learned to be more comfortable in the unknown. I've had various projects, entrepreneurial pursuits. When I was younger, I would always kind of have this strong desire to get these answers that were so unknown or these problems that were unknown solved as soon as possible. And if they weren't solved, it was really irritating and frustrating and call it impatient as well. But over time, I think I've learned that not having all the answers is okay, as long as you, your colleagues, and your team are working towards getting those answers and slowly picking away at figuring out how to solve those problems to get the answers that you need. It may not come right away. Actually, it usually never comes right away. It usually is a result of other teams working on or other colleagues working on things, and slowly bits and pieces of information start to come together to give you that complete answer. But that takes time and also trust with your team and your colleagues that you're working on getting the right answers. Collaboration is probably the most important thing for that. And then as you start to plug through the problem and you get the answer, the unknown becomes known and you feel a lot more comfortable with what the answers that you have and the information that you have. So almost it's as if that unknown piece that was frustrating no longer becomes frustrating.
You mentioned something very astounding to me. You're very candid about it too, that by the age of 12, you had 10 surgeries. What toll did that take on you, not only physically, but in other levels of your life?
Yeah. So I spent the first 3 years of my life in a hospital. By the time I was 12, I had 10 major surgeries, one of them being open heart. As a child, I think it was more of a physical toll, but I think the people that I always felt like had to endure the most, both physical and emotional, were my parents. And I'm extremely grateful for them for having to, although I didn't have a choice, but I had to put them through that. And it's always been a weight I've always carried on me. And I know my parents are amazing that they never really held me accountable for that because it was beyond their control and beyond my control. But growing up, as I started to feel more about my body, learn more about my body, you become very aware of how your body reacts to certain things, when you start to not feel well, the signs that your body's telling you, hey, be careful. You probably are not going to feel well in the next few days and things like that. You become very sensitive to those things. So I've always been very attuned to my body, but I've learned to adapt with that. And I think the most important thing is just being connected with your body, and at least for me, being connected and understanding there are certain telltale signs that your body will tell you, and you learn from those types of things to be careful. But it's a process more than anything. I think your body always has ways of telling you certain things, and it's just a matter of you paying attention to them.
Yeah. I know also, as well, you mentioned this, having the clarity that you're looking out to the world and wondering how things can be better, that fueled a desire for you in that.
Yeah. I've always looked as a child as the world as a playground. And then growing up, that playground was more changed into what can be done better, if that makes any sense. And then I've always had this desire, if things can be done better, can I be the person to create those things to make people's lives better? And I've always been drawn to something tangible that people can hold. I don't know if that's because as a child, I just like playing with toys and things like that. So my approach to the world of solving problems and having and making things simple or easier for people has always been something that they can use or hold. So I always looked out to the world and said, if this can be done better or faster or easier, or why are people confused by certain things? Is it because something's missing? And what is that thing that's missing? And I continue to write those things in a book. And sometimes, at least once or twice a week, I'll go back into the book and see those problems and just see if I can figure out a solution. And if those solutions have changed over time, so be it. But I think it's a good way to just train your brain to look out into the world and say, hey, these are problems that I've identified. How can they be simplified, made easier, or is there a way to make it easier for people on a day-to-day basis? It's almost kind of like a mental training that I like to do.
Even with this origin story of how you started Recoup, this idea of power of the plants and being a supportive adjunct to someone's wellness journey, how have you found evidence of its positive benefits in people's lives?
Yeah. Well, I'm living proof of the positive benefits. My mom was the one who created various types of ginger beverages, ginger tonics, ginger teas while I was after surgeries and had me take them. So that helped with my recovery, specifically in the absorption and digestion component. But going forward, when we originally started off, we were giving our beverage out to people who were experiencing nausea and vomiting from cancer, athletes who were experiencing delayed onset muscle soreness. And I ended up going after undergraduate school and graduating, I ended up going back to the hospital I worked in, working with kids with heart and lung disease. And that's where I combed through medical research and found medical research that said that 2 teaspoons of ginger has been known to help with delayed onset muscle soreness. It's been known to help with post-operative nausea and vomiting from day surgery through anesthesia, nausea and vomiting from chemotherapy. So I was just creating the beverage and giving it out to people who, close friends who were experiencing those types of things. And as that happened, my friends would come back and say they enjoyed the beverage. Can they just buy it straight from us directly? So our market went from people who were not feeling well to just everybody. And we just continued to sell through friends of friends and word of mouth. But yeah, I think with ginger, the research is out there and on the benefits. And we've had a ton of people tell us that they use they drink our beverage after workouts because they find it, one, invigorating and energizing, and two, that it helps with their workout recovery. So that's always exciting to hear.
Yeah. Yeah. In the article, I mentioned that we all are a byproduct of our mentors and advisors. Who have been some of your most notable ones in your life?
Yeah, I would say I'm part of a alma mater's founders group as well. And they've been great. But I will say that there have been numerous people that have helped me throughout both my professional career journey as well as my entrepreneurial pursuits. But the one that stands out is the founders group that I'm a part of. And that's always been great. We meet once a month and for a half an hour, and we are able to kind of share any challenges, any problems that we have, and are there any resources that our network can help each other. But to be honest with you, my close friends back from elementary school have been great too. Yes, is the soundboard. Not so much on the pursuit of specific industries like the CPG world or food and beverage, just overall, they've been a great support in just making sure that you have your eye on the target. There are always going to be challenges. Life's full of ups and downs, and they've just been a great soundboard. Sometimes they're great to provide support, and sometimes they provide harsh criticism, which is needed. So that's always nice.
Yeah. So really, I want to come back to the purpose of today's conversation. How do you define resilience?
Yeah. I define resilience as the ability to recover from a setback, adapt to changes, or keep going in the pursuit of adversity. That's kind of how I would define it.
Yeah. You know, that, you know, you mentioned that it coincides with this idea of grit, a growth mindset, perseverance, yeah, understanding of self and patience. You know, it seems like a very doable thing, but it's often very hard to put it into action. What have you found that sort of works in order to do that?
Yeah. Came across grit and growth mindset through a friend's recommendation on the two books by Angela, one by Angela Duckworth, and then Carol Dweck was this growth mindset. And in grit, it was this mindset that you should be able to kind of go out into the world and try a bunch of different things. But once you find something really that you truly love, that you're happy doing and you're passionate about, focus 100% of your attention onto that. And this mindset of grit is usually, once you find that thing and you want to pursue it, you'll have a lot of people that kind of go against the grain and tell you it's really hard, it's impossible. But having grit is usually this mindset that, like, no matter how much adversity you encounter while you're pursuing this passion, you keep going. And even though the odds are stacked against you, because I think if you want to excel in any industry, regardless of whether it's an athlete, whether it's the CPG world, regardless, if you want to be at that pinnacle point in that industry, it's an uphill battle and it's a climb. And grit, I think, is something that is probably one of the most important things. As for a growth mindset, I think just having that mindset of, okay, I didn't do well, but I can do better next time, is something that sounds simple, like you had mentioned, but a lot of, I'm guilty of it too. A lot of people will take that approach. Okay, I can do better next time, but why didn't I do better this time, right? You look back into it and kind of say, like, well, did I give it my all? Well, I did give it my all, but for some reason it didn't work out. And it's okay. Just go back to it, reevaluate, and understand what could have gone better or what you should have done better, and then continue to pursue forward. I think that mindset is huge, as opposed to what Carol Dweck says, having children take a math test and say, like, oh, I'm just not good at math. And then the other student says, well, I didn't do well this time on this test, but doesn't mean I can't do well next time. I think that mindset, that differentiation is huge, and that distinguishes. And I think you should have really the latter. It didn't go right this time, but next time it'll probably be better than this, or I can do better next time, or if I'm more prepared, or however you want to approach it, the next time I have this opportunity, I won't mess it up, or I can do better, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
Those two, I think, through a friend's recommendation on those two concepts, and I think those are just fantastic. Perseverance is something I think we all can, we all have, and we all choose to devote time to it or not. It's a matter of whether we want to or not. And I think that goes back to grit. Once you find it, what that one item or that one thing, or maybe a group of things that you really are passionate about, perseverance is extremely important. And continue to keep going at it, even though it's mundane, even though it can be bland at some points in time. And there's certain aspects of it that you may not necessarily like. The mundane portion of it, the day-to-day that just is so boring, but you continue to persevere through it because all the other things or all the other processes if you enjoy. So a strong understanding of self, that has come with age for me. I think from an understanding of myself from a more of a physiological component. I've learned that at a very young age, but I just understanding my characteristics and understanding that there are certain things I should be able to control more, be more patient is something I think I've learned over time. And I think that has been the most important component, which goes to patience. Having a good understanding of self, I think just comes with time and just taking time for yourself, if that makes any sense. And I think when I was younger, I didn't really necessarily take that time for myself. You're always kind of moving forward without thinking, head down, focused on kind of your career. You're doing everything for everyone else, if that makes any sense. And that's probably because of your career, because you want to get to where you want to get in that 3, 5, 7 year plan that you have. And it's really for everyone else and not so much for you. But I think there comes a point in time where you look back and you're kind of like, all right, well, did I get to travel as much? Did I get to go to this country and enjoy their food and just take time to take off my shoes and walk on the beach, enjoy the sand through my feet? Did I do all that? And it's not to say that it's not too late, but at some point in time, people all should take that moment and just reflect on, like, have I done things that I've always wanted to do? And do I understand what it is that I like to do and why, if that makes any sense?
In the piece, I asked a very purposeful question about resilience and courage, if mm-hmm. you see them as one and the same or different. What is your view on that?
Well, I define courage as doing something that frightens you, or the ability to kind of endure something or pursue something that frightens you. And I think we should all be able to at least attempt to do things that frighten us. It allows us to get a better understanding of ourselves. And it also allows us to kind of, once we accomplish those things that we're slightly afraid of, it brings them down to reality and makes them human, rather than, I think, this mindset in your mind that it's a fear or it's something out there that you should be afraid of. So I would say having courage is really important. I think it runs parallel with resilience. We should all try and do things that we're slightly afraid of, for the most part, often. But just, I also think that there's a thrill to it as well, to a certain extent. So it makes you live life a little bit more on the adventurous, if that makes any sense.
You spoke so beautifully about persons who, for you, come to mind when you think of resilience, and you spoke about your parents.
Yeah.
How has their life and what they've done influenced yours and allowed you to carry some of those teachings?
Yeah, our parents are amazing. They've always been extremely supportive of everything I've done. And as a child, they always forced me to kind of make sure I wasn't different from everyone else, even though I might have been slightly different growing up. But from my father, I learned hard work, determination, even I would say resilience as well. My father has a ton of grit, and just growing up, I saw that every day. From my mom, I've learned kindness and empathy. She's an extremely understanding woman. She loves hearing people's stories, and I think that's probably one of the things that I really enjoy from her, and I love hearing her tell stories. So both of them have been just great role models for me. Again, they picked up in their late 20s and decided to come to the US and start a new life. And that in itself is just courageous, and they've been able to have a family and stay in the US. So I think there's resilience in that. And they continue to enjoy each other's company, which I think is amazing. Right now they're both retired and they're spending, when they can, they'll spend 6 months here and 6 months in Thailand, escape the cold weather here in the Northeast. So, yeah.
Awesome. Another question I've asked about, if someone ever said something was impossible. And you mentioned literally was starting your company, Recoup.
Yeah.
And people were saying, it's the beverage industry. It's so jam-packed with so many options. How'd you navigate toward, around that?
Yeah, that is a great question. I started off creating the beverage in the apartment of my kitchen. Bought a juicer. And then I started to ask around, asking people a little bit more and reaching out to other people in the industry, reaching out to my alma mater. And every time you reach out, everyone will tell you, oh my God, it's the most competitive industry ever. And to be honest with you, it is. It is the most competitive industry. You go out there and you look at any type of supermarket or any type of convenience store or any type of store with beverages. You look out in the refrigerated section or even the shelf stable section. There's just so many choices. You're bombarded with so many different brands and varieties, and it's hard to choose. I just continued because I felt like our mission and the product that we had was something that was unique, that I loved, that was a reflection of my own personal growth. And again, this mindset that I have of, I really would love to just provide something and make something that people can hold and enjoy. And if it can help people's lives, then I would be a happy person. So that has been the core. And then the mission that has evolved is where we lay our foundation down as a company, my co-founder and I, and we make decisions based on making sure that we follow our mission. And I think that is, those are the pillars that kind of continue, allow us to continue forward. But yeah, I mean, I'd be lying to you if I told you that every step during the process, there wasn't someone who said, this is impossible, or good luck to you. Let's see if you're still in business in a year. I've had co-packers tell us like, oh, okay, we'll produce your beverage, but you probably won't be in business next year. And kind of like, okay. But we continue to be in business and we continue to move forward, which is exciting. So, yeah.
Well, you know, you also spoke in the article about setbacks and how for an early age, because of your health problems, that set the tone for you to constantly persevere and strive. What's the vision look like for you with everything you want to achieve, given the fact that you've came through such hardship in the beginning?
Yeah. I think everybody innately has the mindset to continue to persevere. It's just a matter of whether you let fear or what I call outside noise get in the way. I've had this vision of my career path, again, to be something along the lines of being able to look out into the world and solve certain problems and build things to make, build tangible things for people to enjoy and make life easier. I hope going forward, I can continue to do that within the beverage industry, within food, and within other industries as well. We'll see how that goes. I think as we get older, we look at opportunities different. They present themselves in different ways. It's just a matter of how we look at them. So hopefully Recoup grows to a point where we are able to help to get the beverage into hands of people and have them enjoy it, lots of people. And we'll see where we go from there. And I would love to continue to build things to help people and make life easier for people. So that's kind of always been my vision. As long as I can continue to do that, I'll be very happy and fulfilled.
Great. So what are your five steps that someone can take to be more resilient?
Yes. The five steps. First, I'll tell you what I do. And I think that might be a platform for other people. But I usually wake up every morning, I look in the mirror, and I just say out loud the five things I'm grateful for. And that's how I start off my day. I also kind of envision what is ahead in store for me for that day. And again, if there is anything that is unknown, it usually is the first thing that pops to my mind, but I learn to be okay with that. And that's important. If there are any challenges that are coming up for this day or this week, I usually just acknowledge them and have that mindset that we're working on a way to solve those problems. I try and get out and walk as much as possible, get some fresh air. And I meditate. That is something that has really been important to me. Either a midday, I take about 5-10 minutes just to kind of clear my thoughts. If I can't do it in the middle of the day, I'll tend to do it in the early afternoon. The 5 or 10 minutes just to kind of reset, I think that's important. And then the last thing I like to do is I like to surround myself with people that I know as a check-in that can help push me to reach my goals, because sometimes you just end up getting caught in the day-to-day and things get thrown your way where you're just focusing on solving those issues and you're not really looking at kind of your long-term goals, your professional goals and things like that. So it's always nice to just check in with friends that can help kind of pull you back into kind of your bigger vision of where you want to be in your career. Your professional career. So those are the things that I tend to do. Connecting with friends is always difficult, so it doesn't happen every day. It might be every other day or at least once or twice a week, but that is important because they're the ones that'll help steer you, kind of get you back on track if you're not necessarily on the right path for your long-term vision and goal. But yeah.
Yeah. So I'd love to just transition just for a couple of minutes, what sure. I call brainstorming. And there was a question I asked about who would you connect with or where would you see? And you mentioned one of my favorite thought leaders, authors, Simon Sinek, start with the why.
Yeah.
I think it's such a simple idea. Well, what's my why? But it's really difficult because it forces you to think deeply about yourself. I'm just wondering, maybe you and I can just talk about a minute or two. How can someone ferret out their why?
Yeah. I would say go out there and experience different things. I've never been good at drawing or painting, and I've taken painting classes before just to experience what it's like. So I think don't be afraid to do things that you're not good at, and it's okay if you're not good at them. Try those types of things, at least understand what they feel like. I think that's the most important thing. And I think it's safe to say that I spent most of my 20s and probably the early part of my 30s just trying different things. I started different companies and grew them to a certain point. Some of them completely failed. Some of them have grown to a certain point, just didn't hit critical mass, but I tried. And in trying, I learned that those processes of creating things is really what I enjoy the most. It wasn't necessarily the product in itself. It was the process of creating them, getting hit with certain challenges and figuring out different ways to kind of overcome those challenges. That's what I enjoy the most. I think that's important. I would say try different things, especially things that you're not necessarily good at. And I also think when you're not good at them, at least you've experienced them and know what it's like. That's I think, important.
Yeah, I think what comes to mind for me is two things. One, I think you need to do market research on yourself. And the way to do that is to survey your friends and family. Just ask them qualities of what they see in and around you. And it's funny because a priest, when I was, I think like 14 or 15, just said to me, like, what do you want to do? And I was just like someone who was always into IT. My background is IT.
Yeah.
And he said, I remember him telling me, because I was an altar boy, and remember, he's like, that's not where you need to be. You need to be talking to people, around people. And I thought it was just so weird. And it's what he saw within me. And I think sometimes people get clouded in what they see as too hard. So if you survey your friends and family or just people close to you, they could probably give you some insight into what you naturally do.
Yeah. So
it's just a thought.
I think there was an episode where Simon Sinek did the same thing where he said, go to your closest friends. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know.
Okay. And just ask them, like, what is it that you like about me, or how would you describe me as a person? And he said the first few times when you reach out to your friends, it's a little awkward, but by the third or fourth time, they understand the seriousness behind the question, and they're the ones that give you the best feedback and give you the best idea of how they see you. And sometimes you as a person don't get to see those strengths. And there, it's your close friends that actually are the ones that bring those strengths out for you, to you, so that you become aware of them. Because most of the time, you're not aware of them. So yeah, I think it's a great point.
Yep. Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Siwat. I really appreciate it. Before we go, where can my viewers and audience and listeners find out more about you and your work?
Yeah, so you can find us on our website, which is recoupwellness.com. You can follow us on Instagram, which is @recoupwellness. And those are the two platforms. You can feel free to reach out to us. And we're happy to answer any questions if you're interested in learning about more about our vision and our company.
Well, thank you so much, Siwat. Really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Take care.
Sure.
Bye.
Bye-bye.